Okay, we're here interviewing Mr. Guy Miller Hogan, born December 21st, 1938. Served in the U.S. Army from 1961 to 1964. And achieved the rank of SP4. We're in Brentwood, Tennessee. I'm Commander Brian Allen, friend of Mr. Hogan. Philip and Esther Lee are also present. This interview is being conducted for the Veterans History Project at the Library of Congress. Okay, Mr. Miller, if you would just kind of explain how you came to join the Army, maybe where you're born and raised. And
well, I was born in Stuart, Mississippi, a small mill town in Mississippi. Grew up in Greenwood, Mississippi, which is area south of Memphis. I think I always had a desire, even from an early age, to want to be in the military. I went into the Boy Scouts when I was 12 years old. Of course, that's not, you know, I learned a lot there. Joined a local wing of the Civil Air Patrol and spent 3 years in there before I went on to college, the university. It was during that time that it seemed like I began to become more desirous, as that's the word, to, you know, be a part of the military. When I got to Mississippi State University, I was in the Air Force, ROTC, and that was a turning point for me right there, because when I finished my 2 years of ROTC, my desire had been to be a pilot, but I just didn't have the physical qualities or whatever that, and I didn't want to commit for 6 years at that time. But anyway, during that time, I was taking a summer school course, and one day in the dorm room, this guy walks up and he says to me, he says, Mr. Hogan, we're from the U.S. Army. We are actively recruiting for the United States Army Security Agency. And your name has been submitted to us, and we would like for you to consider, you know, doing it. And of course, they always use the phrase, well, you're going to get drafted anyway, you know. So the lesser of two evils. But anyway, I went for a interview, and I had to fill out a lot of, you know, paperwork to qualify for, you know, security clearances and that type of thing. At the university, we had always joked that at that particular time, we would probably get our diploma on one end of the podium and be inducted on the other end. Well, that was just about the way it turned out, because I graduated in August 1961, and I think it was on the 12th, and then on the 13th I was on my way to Fort Jackson, South Carolina, to be inducted and then through basic training. During that time, I can remember it's probably the worst time of my life as far as what you, you know, it's not the worst time, I'm just saying it's the type of thing that you start to be realizing, you know, discipline is the main thing that you've got to, you can't be yourself. You got to do it one of the two ways. He always said, my way, your way, and the Army way. Well, the Army way always prevails. So as soon as you learn that, I think I felt pretty good, you know, as in the service. So I went through basic training at Fort Jackson, South Carolina, in the heat of the summer. Finished there. Got my orders to go to Fort Gordon, Georgia, which is a U.S. Army signal school. I had taken some tests, and at that time, they wanted us to become efficient in teletype communications and various other areas of the communication program. I went through school there, and then received my orders to go to Japan, and I would be assigned to the U.S. Army Security Agency Communication Unit in Japan. It was USASACUJ was the designation. I had a short leave at home and flew to San Francisco at the U.S. Army Open Army Terminal to, we were either going to fly out or go by ship. Everybody was hoping we'd get to fly, but as it turned out, at that particular time in military history, things were going on, so they took most of us loaded us on a ship. It was called the USS Breckenridge. I'll never forget it. My first time to ever be on a boat or a ship of that size. And we sailed from Oakland Army Terminal. I remember it was a pretty exhaustive trip because we had to go up north from San Francisco up around the Aleutian Islands. And we got up there, and it was like 3 days, I think it was, nothing but intense storms. I didn't think we'd, you'd watch the front of the ship and go under. Say, well, that's not going to make it back up, you know, this is it. I'm going to the Army, I'm going to get taken out before I ever get to my duty assignment. But anyway, after 12 days of the sea, we landed in Yokohama, Japan, and of course after being that long, we had to get processed, and then they gave us a few days off to kind of get our feet back on the ground and to learn to not learn, just to get ourselves acclimated, you know, to a different environment. I went from Yokohama to a place called North Camp Drake, which was on the northwest corner of Tokyo, maybe about 10 miles out. There were a number of other military installations there. There was a U.S. Air Force at their major headquarters there at Tachikawa. And then the Army had our Far East command there. But our unit was a separate unit. All the duties were classified. We were told very emphatically, you know, that you don't talk about what you do, you know, and that we, although being in Japan, we were guests of the Japanese government. We were to be there as their guests and to serve our country in that particular location. When I got there, had been assigned to the telecommunications specialty, but going through some more interviews while I was there, I was asked to become a crypto material specialist, working with a lot of different items in crypto. Of course, today, the security clearance required, you know, I had to have that extra crypto. And so I had to wait another, you know, 2 or 3 weeks for them to clear that. But I went on duty, and that was the major part of the duty, was being, you know, involved with the crypto sections. So there in Japan, I think I met a lot of good people. Most of us were out of, some like myself were just out of college. Others had graduated high school, looking for, you know, something to do. And we just became a pretty tight unit because we were wanting to take care of each other, you know, and to always, you know, watch each other, make sure that we didn't, you know, make a mess up, make mistakes or anything. But all of the time that I spent there, I took advantage of being in a foreign country to try to get out and to learn, you know, some of the culture, the habits, and tried to learn the language, but just didn't have enough time. We worked 24/7, and the time we had off, we didn't really want to spend that time studying, you know, a foreign language. So, but it was a interesting area because in 1961-62, we weren't too far past, you know, World War II, and the people there were very, they always found most of them to be very friendly. I very seldom ever ran into anybody that, you know, showed any animosity toward, you know, being, you know, an American on, you know, at Japanese soil. And they were all eager to learn English. And I had a lot of unique experiences going to different functions or whatever, and meeting somebody that was a Japanese national. And they would always come up to you and they'd say, you know, they want to practice their English, and half the time I couldn't understand what they were saying, but the most of them carried a pad, you know, so they could sit or, you know, write your message, and then they could read it, you'd write a message back. It was one of the things I remember is funny. One of the funny things is they could not say, you know, the Japanese people had trouble with R's. And we were talking to a young guy one day. He was asking us about things that we did in the country, and I could tell you birthdays and all. And he said that on his birthday, that it was traditional to serve lead lice. You know, and I said, what? He said, lead lice. I thought he was saying dead lice. You know, I said, no, I said, but it kind of dawned on me what he was saying was, it was that red rice was there. You know, it was traditional, like we eat in the South. You know, the black-eyed peas on New Year's Day, that's supposed to bring good luck, but the rice brings good luck to the Japanese. So, yeah. But one of the things that I've enjoyed in retrospect is I've stayed in touch with a lot of the guys, you know, over the years. And we've had two reunions where we've gotten together and talked about old times, and it was more exaggerated than you would think. You know, you know what happened and what, and how the story grows, you know, after a few years, and try to remind some people of some of the things that they did. And, you know, it was kind of a just a real fun time to be able to reminisce. But I spent my 2.5 years on active duty there in Japan. And to back up, because I remember when we first got there, I'm going to kind of back up a minute there. When we first arrived, the Berlin crisis had taken place. And a lot of the guys who had been close to being able to come back to the States got duty extended, and they had got an extra 6 months. So when we got there, we were the guys that was going to take their place. But some of them, you know, it just wasn't, you know, they were still on long term. But I can remember guys saying to me, he said, well, boys, y'all, hope y'all don't get extended, you know, we've been here a long time. And I said, well, if things don't change, maybe we'll get out, you know, without any real problems. Well, I guess the most significant thing that happened while I was there was the Cuban Missile Crisis. And we went on full alert. We were on, I guess, I don't remember the terminology, red alert or whatever the color. We stayed on that for almost 3 days without, I mean, I was on duty, I stayed on duty. And I remember vaguely, I say vaguely and vividly, you know, all of the tension and all that was going on, because, of course, we didn't have the communication system we got now with satellites and all this. We were relying on radio reports, teletype, you know, messages, this type of thing. But we were, although we were on the other side of the world, we felt like we were right, you know, right in the middle of it. Whatever happened there was going to happen there, you know. So, but it, of course, was settled, and we moved on to other things. But stop a minute. Lost my train of thought there just for a minute.
That's okay.
Yeah. I wanted to continue a little bit of the things that were happening there in Japan. One thing that I remember, my first military payment we received in what I guess they call it, scrip. I brought some along. I don't know if this will show up on the camera. But denominations from a nickel to a quarter, a 10 cent, you know, because of the black market and all in Japan, we had to use this. I mean, we could only spend this on base. And of course, you were in deep trouble if you went out and tried to use it, you know, off post. But Anyway, I thought that was interesting. We called it the funny money, or, you know, monopoly money. That's what it looked like. But it's spent just like anything else, because we had our own, you know, base, the BX, which was operated by the Air Force, and then we had all of our, you know, clubs, you know, for our social activities. And didn't really need that much cash, except to go outside, because we had a lot of people that managed to, what was the term we used, payday, living, payday, paycheck to paycheck. Some people, even though they'd come in and they were learning how to manage your money. And so, I don't know if other guys in the service would agree with me, but some guys, I guess, learned the hard way. That's one of the things I think the military service, you learn things that help you later in life. I think that was one of the greatest things that I got out of not only being able to, the privilege of serving my country and being a part of a military organization, just being faithful, you know, to our duty. I was just trying to remember that I have trouble with my memory of senior moments. But I can remember that it was quite a challenge or a change when we arrived at North Camp Drake back during the Korean War. It was had been a R&R camp for the U.S. Army. And then across the highway or road was another South Drake, and it was a recreational area, which was the only golf course in the whole area out there. And the Japanese loved to play golf, so we had a lot of Japanese friends that, you know, wanted to help, you know, try to get out there and, you know, play golf, because that was a passion for them to play golf. And if we had a friend or something, we could take them out and let them play the South Camp Drake golf course. There were a number of people that I'm trying to remember that that after, you know, being out of the service, people that you met. I remember one, and I don't know if I'm calling names or anything, but we were sitting in the snack bar one day, and this guy comes over and he sits down, and we get to talking. So where are you from? He said, I'm from Pennsylvania. And he looked kind of familiar, and he got deeper into the conversation. And so what's your name? He said, well, actually, I don't know. I said, Pop, on the name tag there. And somebody says, well, you wouldn't have to be kin to Arnold Palmer, would you? He said, well, he's my brother. Yeah. And of course, you know, that instantly, you know, everybody wanted to know. Because at that time, Arnold was beginning his career, you know. And just by, you know, knowing his brother, you thought, well, you know the champion. You know? So anyway, but it's amazing, you know, that you can, you leave home, you go through training, you go around the world. But no matter where you go, you know, you still have that sense of duty, loyalty to your country, and you want the best for everybody. You know, it's just, you know, you just want to be the best you can be, and you don't want to ever lose sight of that. And I think that helped me in my own personal life. You know, I felt like that what I gained in military service was, I guess, the biggest thing, having become a young, you know, fresh out of college, you know, the world was your oyster, as they said. But in the military, you learn to discipline yourself, and you learn to think about others other than yourself. That, you know, that you lose that selfish feeling that whatever you do, you're going to do not only for others. So And I think that pretty much goes throughout the military. That's what makes it go, is the fact that the discipline, the camaraderie, the bonding that takes place, that is what makes it so unique. We're all faced, you know, with duty that ranges from being on the front line, being in harm's way, sitting back in a clerk's office typing, whatever the job may be, but it's an integral part. It's all one big, a unit, and each part has its purpose, and it all works to the good. And it's all support for each other and for the goal that which you're assigned to do. I remember one of the things that I found in some of my stuff that I was looking for, I found what I call a short time calendar. And just about 6 months, I went, you figure, well, 6 months, that's too far out, but by that time, you're beginning to count the days, even if it is a long time. But we'd go in on our teletype machine and figured out how many days we had left. And we called it our short time, and this was my own personal one I put over my desk. And each day I'd go through and, look at it, count the days. And I had it counted in reverse, from down, right down to day zero, and hoping that something wouldn't, come about at that time to prevent us from going home. And there's another funny thing that I remember, and this is backing up a little bit. Two of my best buddies were getting out just a little bit earlier than we were, and for weeks we heard, going home, and kind of just like rubbing it in, you guys still here, we going home. Well, anyway, they went out to the air base there, Tachikawa air base there in Japan, to get the flight home. And while they were about halfway over the Pacific, they were supposed to land in Anchorage, Alaska, and that was when the big earthquake took place in Anchorage, and they couldn't land, and they couldn't divert them, so they had to turn around and go back to Japan. Well, you talk about some disappointed people, but they thought, well, something is really, we're going back, we ain't going to go home, but... They made it back, but one of the guys is a friend of mine, lives up in Louisville, Kentucky. He swore he would never, ever be, when he was through, he was out of there. And it wasn't 6 months just before I left, he came back to Japan. He reenlisted, and he stayed in another 4 years. But he was one of the ones that was going home, was on the flight that got turned around. But those were some of the... things that happen, that kind of amusing to us, because I know how he would feel, is to be about halfway, almost home, and then bang, you gotta go back, So, anyway, I'm kind of rambling around here, just my thoughts. There's so much that took place in those periods of time that, just all the beauty stuff.
Did you get any other R&R places outside of Japan, or like the Philippines or anything like that?
Well, we didn't outside of Japan. Now, we could do that to go on R&R if you get space available, on a flight to go, say, to the Philippines or Korea or whatever. In fact, I thought about one time, I'd always wanted to visit the country of Australia. And to do that, I could get a military flight from Japan to a certain location, and I had to go on a the RAF, or the Royal Australian Air Force, I guess it was. But after research, there was about five of us that wanted to do that, and we found out, if we got down there and we got stuck, we were stuck, it was either that or spend some big bucks, on a commercial flight back home. So we gave that up, and I guess one of the most unique experiences I had over there was five of us got together and planned on our next, we take a few days of leave, and every morning when we go to work, if it's a clear day, you could look just out ahead of you, you can see Mount Fujiyama, which is, snow-capped mountain. Well, in August, the snow was light, and we decided, well, while we're here, why don't we climb? You know, go out there and climb Mount Fujiyama. So we didn't have all the gear. I mean, it's really not that big a climb. I mean, it's steep and it's rugged, but you don't have to have all the gear that you need. You know, ropes and climber's axes and all that stuff. So we went down to the supply and checked out some equipment, canteens and other stuff that we need. So we boarded a train in Tokyo and went out to right at the foot of Mount Fuji, and we cheated just a little bit because along the lower areas, you know, tree line, and we hired this guy to take us in a truck up there, and then we got out of the truck, and then it's like this the rest of the way. It's all it is really, it's a big cinder pile, just a mound of ash and cinders that had blown out of the volcano. But we started about 6 o'clock in the evening. And we climbed all night long, and about 3 or 4 o'clock, we were at about 3/4 of the way up, and air was getting thin, and everybody was sitting there, you know, kind of breathing kind of hard, and you could see the top, but then you got to think, well, you know, gosh, I'm just give out. I can't make it the rest of the way. I'm just gonna sit. But anyway. You could just barely, at that altitude, you could barely see on the horizon, you could see that pink glow. You couldn't see it on the ground, but up there you could see the, so as it began to get a little lighter, we looked up and we said, yeah, we can make it. So anyway, made the rest of the way up, got there just in time to be there when the sun broke, on top of the, come over the horizon. So that's one of the most glorious sights I'd ever seen, was standing on top of that mountain. Looking out across, that sunlight in the clouds, down below. But that was one of the experiences I had while I was, getting there in Japan. Took some trips around the country, went down to Hiroshima. I think the correct pronunciation is Hiroshima. Got a space safe flight on a Marine C-130 down to down below Hiroshima. And came back and spent the night there. And the next day, we went out and toured the city. And until you see it, I mean, then it's been restored at that time. Even then, it was restored to a degree. But right in the center was the ground zero of the church that's still there as a symbol. And it was just being there. Realizing what had happened there, there's been a lot of things said about it, but I just felt, I get to the point, it's hard to put together the thoughts that you have that people, that were killed, the number of people that were killed in that blast, but here again, being realizing from the standpoint of our country, it had to be done. There was no other way. Which I've learned later on, reading stuff about it. But anyway, just standing there in Hiroshima was another experience. We took another side trip down to Kyoto, which was the original, capital of Japan. And it was pretty much kept. The buildings and all, some of them have been restored, but some of them almost look like original buildings. Learned a lot about the early history of Japan. I'm running out of things here.
Okay, doing fine. But talking about meeting your wife and all, was that after you got discharged from the Army?
So after I got discharged from the Army, I got discharged at Oakland Army Terminal in California. And I decided, I had two ways to get home. Either fly or take the bus. But I've been gone for so long and I'd flown enough, I said, I'm going to just take the bus and it's going to be three or four days longer. at least I get to see my good old USA again. And so I remember coming back to Memphis and then catching another bus to my hometown in Greenwood. Of course, haven't seen my family, you know, in all those years. People change. I have a baby sister, very young. She's almost grown up, you know, when I come back. But after that, after I got back, I was only there in my hometown maybe about 2 or 3 weeks, and I got a phone call from a company in Ohio. They were looking for someone to be a sales rep for the Mississippi, Alabama, Florida area. And of course, I didn't have any experience, but they said, well, we're willing to train you. So I went up to Cleveland, met with them. They said, when do you want to start? And I said, as soon as you're ready for me. So they transferred me down to Asheville, North Carolina. And there in Asheville, we had a regional warehouse, and that's where I began to, you know, meet the people in the company. And I was given the territory after 6 months training. Went to Meridian, Mississippi, located there, and stayed in Meridian for about a year and a half. And then I got a call to come to Nashville. When at first I don't want to go to Nashville. I'm happy right here. You know, Nashville, the country town, all the country music. I'm not going up there. All right, well, we'll see. But I was out a week and I came back in, the phone rang. I said, it's a matter of not whether you want to, you got to. You know, we need. So anyway, I packed up, and of course, been at the time being single, I packed up and moved to Nashville and moved over on Fairfax Avenue, which is right in the shadow of Vanderbilt campus over there. And rented an apartment. And and people, we always laugh about this. We get in a group of people and we say, well, how did you meet your wife? And I said, well, I said, we met at the garbage dump. Everybody looks at you crazy. I said, I had seen her walking out, you know, because I was gone 5 days a week. A lot of times I'd leave Monday, wouldn't get back till Friday. And this one particular Friday, I'd come in and I saw her go to the dumpster. I said, that's a good opportunity, you know, and I can, you know, at least introduce myself and meet her. So I grabbed up a bag of trash and I went out the door. And just about the time we got to the, you know, you kind of time it, you know, so that we got there and we got to talking. And well, from there on, one thing leads to another, and in about 6 months, we were married. Today, we have two children, a boy and a girl, 5 grandchildren, and they love to hear Papa talk about the military. You know, all the ways they're going to have. I've got a drawer where I keep all my stuff, and they go in there and they want to look at it, and I've got stuff, you know, that I kept, you know, insignias and patches and all that, and they love to do that. They love to go in there and see what's there. Tell me about this, tell me about that, you know. Gives you a chance of the pipe already kind of embellished it a little bit, you know. But anyway, the Army was a great experience for me. I was asked today, knowing what I know and been there and that, I think I would say, yeah, I'd do it again. It was a chance to give back to your country something that, you know, we take for granted. And this sounds like a patriotic thought, but it's the truth. It comes from the heart. That, you know, we live in a country, we've got a lot of good things, and the thing that makes it work is our ability to defend ourselves and to be able to serve. And I count it as a privilege to be able to serve in the U.S. Army in the capacity that I serve. So, is there any other questions or anything? What about her?
No, we're doing great. If you got anything else.
No, that's just kind of, you know, after getting out and being, you know. Anyway.
Right. Well, thank you very much.
That's about all I can remember right off the top of my head.
Well, that was pretty good. Okay. All right. Yeah.